I'm really proud of us for figuring out a way to make the prisoner's dilemma a little more friendly. It turns out, though, that this idea, this sort of core idea, is very general and kind of cool. So it leads us to a topic that we could call repeated games and the folk theorem. Mm-hmm. So the general idea here is that when you're in the repeated game setting, this possibility of retaliation, the possible of, you know, not being cooperative, actually opens the door for cooperation, because now it can become better to just get along and cooperate than to get retaliated against.
Right. And that makes sense, as long as the retaliation is plausible.
Well, we're not talking about plausibility of the retaliation. We're just talking about, right, because the tit for tat, it's just not analyzed in that way. It doesn't say whether or not it's actually plausible. It just says, well, if you have this strategy and you play against this strategy, there's no incentive to switch.
Right.
But we'll get into this plausibility thing in a little bit.
Oh, I stumbled across a word. Okay, go.
But I want to point out one thing first, which actually kind of irritates me, kind of along the same lines as, like, regression is the wrong word and reinforcement is the wrong word. Folk theorem is the wrong word. So what is a folk theorem?
It's two words.
In general, in mathematics, sorry, say again?
A folk theorem is two words.
That's fair, yes. So I think it's actually two different terms of art. So in mathematics, folk theorems are results that are known at least to experts in the field, and they're considered to have established status, but they're not really published in their complete form. There isn't some kind of original publication saying, oh, look, I found this thing. It's more something that, like, kind of everybody knows, and so you don't really give anybody credit for it. So it's like a theorem that is in the general cloud of understanding. It's sort of among the population, among the group.
Wait, does anyone ever prove these folk theorems?
All folk theorems are provable. But it's not like you say that, you know, this is Charles Isbell's theorem. Mm. It's like, no, it's just a folk theorem. It's like Charles can prove it. We can all prove it. But we're not really sure whoever proved it first. It was just one of those things that everybody knows.
Oh, so it's like an oral tradition.
Yeah. I think that's a good way to think about it.
Okay. I'm just imagining mathematicians sitting around a fire in the winter, cuddled up against one another, sharing theorems that have been proved since the beginning of time to one another.
Exactly. Right. That's the image that I have as well. It's folk theorems. It's the sort of, I learned it from my grandmother and now I'm telling you.
Mm. I like that. I like to think of mathematicians that way.
As grandmothers.
Yes.
So so that's what a folk theorem is in mathematics. However, in game theory, it means something different. It is referring to a folk theorem, but it's also referring to a particular folk theorem. So the folk theorem in game theory refers to a particular result that describes the set of payoffs that can result from Nash strategies in repeated games. So it's a funny thing. It's a funny way that they use the word. It's a folk theorem, but it's also the folk theorem.
Hmm. Well, maybe it was actually proven the first time by some guy named Folk.
Oh, that's a good idea. We should push that forward, like call him Folk or something like that. Folk's theorem.
Yeah.
But no.
Oh, well. I tried.
Yeah, that's a really great idea that we're going to just move on from. But what I'd like to do next is kind of build up to this notion of the folk theorem, and it's going to require a couple basic concepts that are not too different from stuff we've already talked about, but we're going to kind of make them concrete, and then we're going to show how they all come together to provide us with this idea of the folk theorem.
Okay.